Okay, so there are a couple of questions which I just want to revert to in the notes which we had. These questions were about the universe, but in order to understand the universe, I mean, what do you think is the origin of the universe? I need to look for them there. Where do you think the world began from? How did the earth, you know, come to be? Anyone has an idea? The spiritual is a bit unbelievable. What do you think, that the world just was, this man made Adam and removed the rib and made Eve, which is almost like the consonant with evil. Then on the seventh day he had already finished everything. Well, I can't deny, because I'm not supernatural, but it depends on who should believe on it and who shouldn't. Why do you put when you are scared? Put comfort and belief, and there shouldn't be any problem. So I'm looking for those questions about the universe, questions that can be able to give us a big deal of what can trigger your interest. And for those of you who have been on Mwele, you are able to really divulge into the notes and read in details more than what I was talking about when I was busy here on the board. And in the notes, the activities, which are just an enhancement of the practicals we do. So you shouldn't be... Yes, I got them. So the key questions which you may be able to answer, or which you should try to answer in your free time: how was the universe formed? How was the universe formed? How old is the universe? The other question is, what is the origin of life? And the other one, is there life elsewhere in space? I found these questions intriguing, pertaining the section of the geometry of space which we have. I know if I gave you a chance to answer these questions, those who are CFDs will hang on me and tell me that in 7 days God created man, created woman, created Eden, created the sun. It was just this swaggerific that we say. Let there be the moon. Then he says, let there be the sun. Then it started shining. I don't know how he was seeing before he could say it was there. Then he would say, there be... And then everyone was being available. Then he would read the ark of Noah, where the world ended, and then he collected female male of everything. And then we were able to survive like that. How old, even man? We haven't known how man is old. Every day archaeologists come up and say that the oldest man is this many million years or this many thousands of years. And what is the origin of life? It confuses me. You've ever had some things like you eat some takeaway and keep away the container, and then you find that white stuff, this making life, where do they come from? For those of you who grew up in the village, I'm sorry to say this when you're about to eat lunch, but those of us who grew up in the village and you have this peat latrine, those things down there, how do they come about? Because they come from nowhere. You don't put any life or that in there, but they exist there anyway. Get the idea?
Yes.
So if you try to look for answers for this, do me a great favor and be able to understand what the universe is all about. But for today, I'm supposed to be going farther ahead and trying to look at the Euclidean geometry and then begin on the Newton's laws of motion. Anyone with a question from behind? The previous sections? Yes, please. Life is the peak depends. If you are talking about life of a human being, is the time a human being can spend while alive. So that's how I understand it. Yeah, you talk about my life, but then there are those who take enjoying things, going to dance and eating life, you know, that I'm enjoying my life. It's like contextual. But in the context of the universe, we are looking at how does something come to live for a given certain period of time. So I can take it, I can take that as the life. I know many laughed because they thought I would give you a different answer. As in either complain or whatever, but I couldn't do that. So today's lecture will be about the Euclidean geometry and Newton laws of motion. Euclidean geometry and Newton laws of motion. I'm not sure whether I have already given you the story of how I got to love physics most. This was when I was a little bit of a new kid. And as a new kid from a mountainous region, I never used to think that there is another world beyond our own home, because it is Mount Elias. So you find that when you would be like in a valley here, if we took a house in the valley here, you would see, for example, the sun rising on one of the hills. Like if you were to be living in Katanga, so if you are in Katanga, you see the sun rising off Mulago or Kororo, whichever you're looking at. And then all of a sudden you see it, you know, setting along Makere. So if you are a kid who is not moving anywhere from Katanga, you may think that Makere is where the world ends, because that's where the sun disappears. So we started going to dig when I grew up a little bit, that I could now walk long distances. We went to dig on top of the hills. And I can assure you that was like a life-changing moment, looking at other hills across. Now, eventually then we got a UEV then vehicle, which used to take sand across the village. So I think the owner of the driver was having a plot, involved in power, but we would get the sand from our village. and I will go this vehicle for you, just to give you an impression. I'm not a good artist, although I got a hair in it. All I'm interested in is this map part. These vehicles have a place here where they can put poles. There's another part here. Poles for electricity. But this time it was current sun, so I went here and stood at the back. The other wise guys who had felt the same problems before, they were here, comfortably hanging on the front. Yeah, I was behind here. So I kind of took comfort. When they are selecting you, the main title on the back. And this guy drove us, and when he reached the tarmac, everything was very comfortable. Until when a car was crossing the road and he stepped on the brakes. So I had to run in the sand. Some of you who have ever been, you know, if you step in sand, you keep sinking. But this time I was running at a terrific speed. No sooner had I reached the front here, maybe hoping these guys would rob me, he accelerated again. Then I had to go reverse again. And I was lucky that it was sun, because every time my speed would be reduced by the sinking in and, you know, getting out, until when I reached the back. When I reached, I held it tight. Of course, coming back, I took refuge in here, behind the driver, because it was in the cabin, in the front cabin, there is behind the seats. There is a space there, so that's why I would hide every time we are going out, because I wanted to go and explore. What is the rationale of this story I'm telling you? That yesterday, I happened to watch these guys who are, they are doing a good job of simple land. This guy talked about capacitors, you know, defined them. He calculated the capacitors in series, in parallel, and then he said, I thank you for having been with me today, son. I'm like, surely when the kid sits in such a class, and you have told him all these things, so what? You get my problem? So what? What does the capacitor do to me? Is it edible? Is it some chips or what? And why would I be putting it in a series anyway? Because every time you put a given two components in a series, they give you a result which is special than these two. I don't want to divulge into that. But what I'm trying to tell you is that some of you will be teaching just to get answers. So for me, I got answers from here. That when we reached N3 and they talked about that the body continues in its state of motion or of rest unless acted on by external forces. For me, it was just deep here. Because I remembered that for when the guy stopped to not knock the car, me, I was still running at its speed in my state of motion. And I continued going. And when he started now to move, I had come to rest, so I wanted to remain at rest, but I can't remain at rest, otherwise I would slide. So instead of sliding, I have to be forced to move. And from that day, I was like, yes, this is what they mean by physics. So it was accidental, this was accidental. But I was never told by any teacher in class. Some of these teachers have never been in a car where they put seat belts. They had bicycles. And you know a bike, you are the controller. You can use or you can. When you are about to negotiate the corner, you the one you are the boss. So the laws of classical mechanics allow us to predict with remarkable accuracy the motion of several parts of the solar system. They suggest possible mechanisms and these mechanisms are those of formation of stars and galaxies. One of you came to my office today about the galaxies. when you look at the cross, those two things where they are like whitish things which go like this, that's guts when you are looking at it in the face. And then there's another one where you see it like from the sides. This is like from the side of it. When you read on the net, you'll be able to find more information which I cannot give. And the notes are very elaborate. So we shall use these laws in everyday life. And for this lecture, we are going to be able to define Euclidean geometry. We shall state some assumptions about space and how we use it in mechanics. We shall state the laws of Newton of motion and calculate simple problems about motion. And the notes are on the web, so I cannot write a lot of stuff in the board. How many of you disagree with my methodology? Surprising that when you go to Facebook, you find many people putting their nice name. How do you call it? Like you find someone's photo very smooth, but when you meet the person in person, you are like, you want to announce that you are not the one who said we meet another person. So the assumptions are that space is Euclidean. The assumptions of classical mechanics are that space is Euclidean. And the reason or the definition of this or the impression of this is this means that the space is geometrically uniform. This means that space is geometrically. We try as much as possible, much as we know that when this is the orbit of the Earth, also having the Moon orbiting around it, and this is the axis, and this is the Sun. We try to, as much as possible, assume that as this orbit goes, although it is elliptical, but there is some kind of uniformity in its geometry. And it is homogeneous so that accepted mathematical rules can apply without contradiction. The other one is that space is isotropic. Those of you who are doing physics, you learn about isotropy. When a material is isotropic, it means that its properties are the same in all directions. And this is because the physical properties are the same. This means that the physical properties are the same in all directions. These are examples of materials such as quartz crystals, which are not as they are. Examples of materials which cannot be uniform all through, like quartz, which are not isotropic. And this property of space is known as invariance under rotation. So, much as we say that space is isotropic, but you find that, for example, quartz is not isotropic, and its property is what we call the invariance under rotation. detailed, once again, as I said, detailed notes are of Mwere. Those of you who find problems with Mwere, contact me, I'll help you out. If you don't know what number your photo is, and you've come and I know how you look like, I can show you exactly the number of your photo. So that we do this week we shall be through. Or if we are through by this week, we shall be able to run very fast. Because we are behind by a whole week, I guess, because of the time I spent trying to excite you, you know, the way. There is an activity, and this activity in the notes, this would be your eye, and then you are required to get a ruler. And from this ruler, you'll be able to look at arm's length. You are supposed to look at the full moon, which will be about 16th of March. So by then, we will have covered something significant. You are able to look at, it should be almost a good circle, but the board, I can't go into this place here. So you look at the moon, and you are able to calculate the diameter of the moon, and knowing how much we are from you who is stepping on the earth up to the moon, you can actually compare with the average values given in the books as the data. It's just an activity for you to get an understanding. So you get a transparent millimeter scale, which should be these plastic rulers, on a clear night or a clear sky night. And when you have a full moon. The full moon for March will be on 16th March. That's when we shall be having a full moon. So on that day, if it is not cloudy, you can carry out this experiment. If I'm around, I may decide to carry out a moon viewing session outside there. And then you should be able to get the angle subtended by the moon on the Earth's surface, and then compare with the standard data. You can also get any other two transparent. In the notes, they are cola pieces. You know the things which come in the cola? The cola of the shirt, which keep it tight. When the shirt is new, I know most of you don't buy new shirts. Like second hand. Me, I would rather put on one shirt, but when I know I'm the only first one to put it on. And putting on many shirts which other people just dressed. Some could even dead when they were taking them away. So you look at the light and try to turn these pieces. So those are just activities to give you an impression. This is the reason why I don't normally come with a projector to show you a lot of stuff. Because now we'll be now, you would be murmuring around. But I guess you are still looking well at the board. So these problems have been a bit. Now, the two properties of the coming out of this. These two experiments, or these two activities which you will do, are able to show us the conservation of linear momentum and of angular momentum. Linear momentum for this, when you are looking at the moon, used through this millimeter scale, and when you are turning these two pieces to cut away the light and see how it behaves, will help you to understand a little bit of angular. Man, I guess when you were doing one of the experiments, those of you have done a couple of them in the lab, the concept of angular momentum comes in when you are doing this experiment with a piece of a plate with these holes, is it? Now, Newton's laws of motion hold in an inertial system. For an observer at rest on Earth, and one takes into account only the acceleration of the Earth. When we are on Earth, we talk of G, and this is the acceleration U, gravity, about 9.8. And sometimes we say, as long as you have a value from 9.7 up to about 11 meters,
a second. Some of you always, like in one of the three blocks, when you have a swinging pendulum, since you've been doing it, and we're talking about the period T from dimensions in your A level, you have to first assume, because the dimensions help us to derive equations. So you have to first assume that this is proportional to the mass, okay? And then to the, because this would impose the, due to gravitational pull, you come up with the weight. So I'll be talking of the mass, acceleration due to gravity, and definitely how long it is would come up with, or would affect how much our pendulum would behave. So I put X, put Y, put Z. In order for this to be true, both of them should be equal. So I'll first say this is equal to K, and the constants are always taken to be dimensionless. So we actually take them as one until proven otherwise. So this being time, I can take it as T, and then I'll first jump a little bit and say K I dimensionless. This is M to the X. This is acceleration, which is meters per second squared. And then I have L to the Z. And eventually we shall be able to come up with T is equal to 2 pi root of L over G when you compare the, because this is M to zero, that is one of the other dimensions, the other one is L, L to zero, and then you compare the indices. I don't want to go into that. And then when you start swinging a pendulum, you are able now to relate that actually the mass is not an issue. And whether you put a wooden pendulum, or whether you put the whole of me and swing on it, whether you get the whole of this building and get a strong string and start swinging it, actually the period will be the same for a given number of oscillations which you take. The other part, for those of you who will be doing practicals, when you are swinging, when you release your pendulum, I mean pendulum, for example, I've released it, when you start counting and you say one, so you say one here, and then it comes back, you say two, do you see how much you've lost? Some of you who have been there, I've tried to explain this when I find you on the practicals, but look, I'm here, I've pulled the ball, and I've released it, and then someone, well, I normally advise that you let it count when you are already in motion. So, normally someone sees it here and says, one, two. Already when you started and said one, it is going this way, and should first come back to say two. But already you have counted one, which was useless because you said one. So if you say one and it goes this way, comes back, that's when you should be saying one. So when you click the clock, when you click it here, you click it go, comes back, then you count one. Otherwise you have been counting using a whole half oscillation. And that's the same with the screen as it goes up and down. So when we talk of Newton's laws or Newton laws of motion, it is only in the natural frame where an observer, I brought this because this is the experiment you were always doing, and at the end of the day you'll have your T squared over 4 pi squared and then L squared equaling to G. This was your slope. No, not this one. When you plot T squared against
L
square. Then you would have your against L.
Yes.
Yeah, against L. This is when you would get your slope as 1 over 4 pi squared, and eventually that would be no. This would be g over 4 pi squared. This was always your slope. And when you would get this slope, normally they never used to tell you that that is your acceleration due to gravity. And then you would just get an answer and then walk away. And I start asking friends, what did you get? Something. But all you needed to do is to get this value you got here, and g would be the same as 4 pi squared x. And if it is in the range of 9.7 to 11, you would be sure that you got your experiment right. I don't know where the problem was when you were still in high school. And Newton's laws of gravitation holds in the Euclidean space, and this law, as we can see, the force between any two bodies, that one we talked about it with a couple of you, who were explaining gravity, when you have any two bodies, the force between them, which we call the gravitational force, is always the same as G mm over r squared. For if I had any mass of capital M, and maybe the moon, which may be small m, or any satellite, and if the distance between their centers is a distance r, and then you would get your g being the same as 6.67, and who knows the units. You don't need to hassle about the units, you don't need to cram them. All you need to do, this is about 10 to the power, is it negative or positive? Negative. And then you derive them from here. This is in newtons, this is in, so we say this is kilogram squared, and this is meter squared, and then you make g the subject. And when you make g the subject, its units will be the same as newton, meter squared, and then you divide by the kilogram, so per kilogram squared, and you have your units as newtons, meter squared, per kilogram. That's how we get the units. So you don't need to round the units and say the units of G, capital G, would be this and that. After we have known these assumptions of the space, Euclidean space being uniform, being isotropic, that is being the same or homogeneous in all directions, then we move on to the Newton's laws of something which made me love physics. Newton's laws of motion. So we look at dynamics of bodies, and when we talk of dynamics of bodies, we look at especially the kinematics of bodies, when we talk about the displacement from one place to the other, and when you displace a body and it has moved with a velocity, we talk of its velocity. When we get interested in the velocity of a body and its mass, then we talk of the momentum, because we know that momentum is the product of the mass and its velocity. And if we are interested in how much this velocity was for a given time, we talk about acceleration. All these encompasses the kinematics. Is it kinematics or kinetics? The kinetics of of a given body. But before a body moves, or before a body does anything, you find that there has to be a force that makes it do so. When this thing is here, it will be here until the end of the world, if no one tries to. So there has to be a force that moves it either this side, or this side, or this side, or that side. And that is what we call a force. And the concept of a force gives a description of the of the mechanical interaction between two bodies. For example, when you push a car in the mud, how many of you have ever done that? You have been saying paper work, so you have to make sure that you get a consonant. You push, you have to make sure you sing something that makes you push at the same time. Sometimes people choose vulgar things that unite them in order to be able to do that. I don't know why vulgarity makes them more powerful. So if you are able to push a calf in the mud, you exert a force on the car, and then when you bump into somebody, when you are walking and you knock somebody, that somebody may sway the other side, you too, you may get the same impact. And that's the concept of the force. And we have different forces anyway. We have tension is a force. If I may just get a little bit of these forces. You have tension as a force. Who can give us other forces? You have, so if I pull a rope, the rope also pulls me. That's why when we are drawing, for example, these force, two forces acting on, if this was our pulley, and we have the masses, we tend to say that this is the weight, M1G, M2G, and we draw the tension when this force acted. Okay, when this force or weight acted, the string also put a force. So we say this is T. When this force weight pulled downwards, this string will try to oppose it to go in this direction. But normally you do this, you just say this is our tension quickly. But in actual sense, as you pull a rope, how many of you looked after boats like me? When you try to pull I hope this is it. When you are trying to pull this goat here, and you put a rope and pull this side, the goat will put the force before you take it. But I normally use a different example. When you are when a goat has given birth, its young one, we call it a kid. And that's why I take all of you as kids, not goats. But as kids, all of you, I take you as kids. Some of you may feel great and big. Now, if it has just been born and you have cleaned its nose and its mouth of that thing, which is a bit, doesn't look good, you know, God is great. They know where to go and pick some milk. But you try to be the one to take it there. It will put a lot of force, just like I normally tell you to go on Mwere. But if you succeed to make it grab the teeth and you try to draw it away, it's a tug of war. And that's why I take you as kids. Some of you, when you realize the usefulness of Mwere later on, if I told you I'm going to shut it down, like I'm closing the course, you say, no, we still want it to be there. Because you are just like kids. You have to be forced to do something. Maybe once you have got into it, you'll be able to enjoy it. So we have tension, we have normal force, we have friction force. My collars always have other nice shirts, which I can't put on because my collars are gone because of the friction. And then you have gravity, all of you jump up and come back down. without any problem, you have to come back. And there are a bunch of other forces, magnetic force, electrostatic force, to mention but
a few.
And you know, if you pushed a body, the body also will try to push you. It's not just the leeway that I push this one over. That's why we feel we are doing well. Because much as I'm pushing it, it is also pushing me, but I'm stronger. That's why we say the resultant force has been the force that has managed to take the body this way. So, for example, on the notes, you'll see this young man who is pulling a piece of box, and is very, looks very strong. And if you took this to be the horizontal, and you see this young man moving this side, I don't know whether I should take it that far, but I can take it along his neck. Is it neck or shoulder? And is moving this side. The good diagram is working well. So you can get the force. If it is theta, of course there is a tension here. And then you can actually get the component of the force, but also is suffering from some friction. So we can say Fr at this point. And if you are pulling a box along the horizontal floor, the force is exerted at an angle theta, then you can get the horizontal component of this force. So we have the force, which I can, of course, there is tension in the string, which we can take it as the force, because it is equal but opposite to the force which was applied. If I have my string on my shoulder, which I don't think I'm pulling it in these days, I'm weak because of over-sitting down. But when I was still young, I used to be strong. I used to have some good muscles, which have disappeared out today. So we shall have a force. Of course, we have the component along the Y, and we shall have the component along the X. So we have the Fx. We have the Fy, and we shall have the resultant force, which is the force that is applying if this is theta. So Fx will be equal to, when you get a component along the x, you are collapsing the theta. So in mathematics, if you are collapsing, you mean it means that you are multiplying with collapsing core. Cosine theta, and if you are going to stretch this angle, stretch, then you say sine. So Fy will be equal to F sine theta. Does it really work nicely that way? And to get the resultant force, you get it as Fx squared plus Fy squared, all that square root. And then you are able to get the resultant force that this gentleman is applying. So every force in our system, we have to make sure that we get, because remember we talked about the two planes, the horizontal and the vertical. So every time we are having a force, we have to first check its horizontal component and its vertical component. And an example, there is an example in the notes which has a definite figure of 120 newtons and 200 newtons, and then you are asked to find the X and Y components. I don't think I should do this. Mathematics people, do you have any problem with this? How many have a problem with this, getting the components of this? Well, since it is my duty to get the components, much as we have the 120 along the horizontal, so if we have the 120 along the horizontal, It means that it is purely horizontal, meaning that it has no vertical component. But that is not just magic. The reason is that when we take the y component of 120, it will be 120, and we shall be stretching a certain angle, which is zero. Because the angle between x and 120 is zero. So we shall say that this would be sine zero, and that would be? So we wouldn't be having any vertical component. And then we would have the 200 being, I think the angle here was, the angle between them is 60 degrees. So you would be able to get this component along here and the component along there. And I'm not really in moods of doing this, because it's in the notes and it is elaborative. If time comes, I may do that in the new course. So first law, who can state for us the first Newton's law? Yes?
A body is a place of in motion and continues moving when it is at rest after being at rest.
And continues moving when it is at rest. Yeah, but if a body is at rest or in motion and continues in that motion, but the other one is rest. Yes, please. Good. So we actually say if this vessel is here, this point will remain here until something happens to it. Either I can apply an external force, I can push it that way. And if there was a friction, like if you roll a trolley, that trolley should be able to roll indefinitely unless acted upon by external forces. Of course, when I push my duster, I mean, my push should have left it moving forever, but the problem is there is friction on the table. Also, there is air resistance. Like when you swing your pendulum in the lab, that pendulum should continue swinging. If it was put in a vacuum, it could swing forever. That's why you have clocks which have swinging pendulums in them. But some of them are enhanced by the battery inside. So it's not that they are acting naturally. So a body continues its state of rest or of uniform motion unless it's compelled by the external forces to act otherwise. If it is at rest, external forces will be able to move it from rest. If it is moving, external forces will be able to stop it. So like if you have a car and you put it in double, you know, and double, like you put it in neutral and it is sloping on a slope, unless if you apply the brakes or hand brake, whatever you are using, it should roll downstream forever. And definitely it should do so when the forces are in equilibrium. That is when you have no resultant forces acting on it, and that should continue indefinitely. Now, when a body is at rest and you apply a force on it, it acquires a speed or acquires a velocity. And that velocity, or that means I can either push it or pull it. And when I do that activity of push or pull, and it has started moving, you can also slow down another one. So if it is already moving, you can grab it and stop it. It is moving and I can slow it down. If you are, if it is a car moving, you can slow it down in the due course. All in all, a force must be applied, either to accelerate it or to decelerate it or to retard it, whichever way you would want to call it. And there is an activity in the notes which you may decide to go in the lab and work on. And the retardation or the acceleration depends on the force you have applied, and that force also depends on the mass and the acceleration that you are able to give the body. So as this, the second law, this is the mathematical expression of the second law, but we can state it as the force. Is it the, we start with the force or we start from here? The rate of change of momentum. The rate of change of momentum of a body is directly proportional to the applied force and takes place in the direction of the force. So if I, retarding means it's like pulling that body. So you make it retard, but although it may not go backwards, but it will slow down in the direction of the applied force. Whereas when you push it, it goes in that direction. And we define momentum as the product between the mass and velocity. So for now I may remove these businesses for comfort of all of you. And when we say, when we talk of the force as the rate of change of momentum, it means that the rate of change of momentum is the same as multiplying it by ddt. So ddt in physics is equivalent to the rate. So this rate would be the same as ddt of mv, which would be the same as m. Mass is a constant. Mass, your mass does not change anyhow. And this would be dt. And of course, we know that the rate of change of velocity is the same as. So this would be the same as ma, which is equal to the force, which we've already said is directly proportional. So that's how we come up with the definition of, or the statement of, second law of Newton. The third law of Newton, we refer using it in a life perspective, that do to others what you wish them to do and to you. So when this guy came busy making signs, food, going to Masaka, how did you know he was going to Masaka? I thought he had told you. You know. So when you give him, then you expect to be given at one time in the same case. That is Newton's third law, that for any action, there is an equal but opposite. Reaction. So law three, when you push a body, the body pushes you back. So your pushing should be a little bit nice if you don't want to be pushed. And when I'm doing stuff, when I'm doing things here, I always put myself in your shoes. When you come in my office and I'm rough at you, I first imagine if you, I think I've asked some of you when you come, But now assume you are me. What should I tell you? And you are always honest. Some of you actually become tougher than I have been. And that's the law of three. But for any action, there is an equal. But opposite reaction. In other words, when you get a book, or when I put this machine here, the table also applies an equal force as the machine applies. So in the notes you find that if you have a table, and on the table you put this machine, for example, and it has applied its weight on the table, this table will also apply a normal reaction M on the machine. So you remain there, but that's why when you jump and hit yourself down, you feel like you are really feeling some pain coming from. That's why people get broken, like when they jump off the building, because the much you are slamming on the ground is the much the ground is also hitting on you. Some of us used to do this. That's why you see my things very tough. Eh? So when our house is made of mud, you know, so we would box it when we are about to reach Christmas and we have to make it give it a facelift. Like in November, we box it hard to make practice. Until when we get it, you know, cracked up to be able to have where the mud will go during towards Christmas. So we will, here you can't box these things, I guess. Those of you, the usual suspects I say that those of Bororo, where do you box? If you hit once, you will go to hospital. So, but when you hit, or if you slapped the wall, if I slap the board, I really feel the pain. Because the board also tries to react towards me. It's almost lunchtime. Yeah, but you see, the other guy took some minutes when I was busy trying to. So, in summary, since you are crying that it is lunchtime, in summary, Euclidean geometry gives a good description of space measurements. And the space is homogeneous and isotropic, and the Newton's laws hold in space we live and can be used to describe the motion of bodies. Any questions? How do you find my approach to these notes? I know you are used to writing a lot of notes on the board, but I have these notes on the way, but if you want them, you know, if you want me to write them here on board every day, I can do that, although it is double work, but I guess I am always hitting on the key points within the notes. And maybe when we do the first test, I'll be able to conclude that either you are not following, but in one way or another, I'll make you go to the way by force. But all notes, they are very explanatory. How many of you have seen them? They are very explanatory with objectives, with examples, and problems at the end of each of these lectures. Enjoy your life.